Hachette Audio presents Songbird, an intimate biography of Christine McVie, written by Lesley-Ann Jones, read by Lucy Tregear. In Memoriam, Anne Christine Perfect, known as Christine McVie, 1943 to 2022. Anne Avril Annie Nightingale, CBE, 1940 to 2024. Robert Bob Brunning, 1943 to 2011. Dennis Carl Wilson, 1944 to 1983. Michael Ralph Moe Foster, 1944 to 2023. Eduardo Quintella de Mendonça, Eddie Quintella, 1944 to 2020. Robert Lawrence Welch Jr., Bob Welch, 1945 to 2012. Peter Alan Greenbaum, Peter Green, 1946 to 2020. Melanie Ann, Melanie Safka Sherkarik, 1947 to 2024. Robert Joseph Bob Weston, 1947 to 2012. Daniel David Danny Kerwin, née Langren, 1950 to 2018. Stephen Malcolm Ronald Nice, Steve Harley, 1951 to 2024. Stephen Richard Steve Wright, MBE, 1954 to 2024. The greater the success, the more money, the more opportunities, the bigger our world became. The more I found myself shrinking inside, reducing, becoming less confident. I thought I needed a man to validate me. I needed coke and booze to fortify me to go on. It was easier somehow to live in that permanent haze than face reality. Those things made me who I was, until they made me who I wasn't. You can only mend the vase so many times before you have to chuck it away. Christine McVie. Such wooing as the ear receives from zephyr caught in choric leaves of aspens when their chattering net is flushed to white with shivers wet. And such the water spirit's chime on mountain heights in morning's prime, too freshly sweet to seem excess, too animate to need a stress. But wider over many heads, the starry voice ascending spreads, awakening as it waxes thin, the best in us to him akin. And every face, to watch him raised, puts on the light of children praised. So rich our human pleasure ripes, when sweetness on sincereness pipes. Though naught be promised from the seas, but only a soft, ruffling breeze, sweep glittering on a still content, serenity in ravishment. From The Lark Ascending, George Meredith's 1881 poem that inspired Ray Vaughan Williams' 1921 masterpiece for solo violin. It was Christine's favourite piece of music. Chapter 1. Prelude. A white weatherboard millhouse leans beside the Little Stour River, keeping watch over the village of Wickenbrew. Across a picturesque green with its 13th century flint-built church of St. Andrew, green-shuttered manor house and grand Queen Anne rectory, lurks an ancient timber-framed alehouse known as the Rose. The homely inn, like the medieval Kentish village itself, is a quaintly photogenic refuge. Locals, walkers and occasional sightseers head here to sup and dine, to toast birthdays, weddings and funerals, to rejoice and to mourn, to ponder time both spent and yet to come. Creaking beams, wood floors and spitting log fires heave with fragments of the bygone and the blown. The prevailing mood is cosy if a little restless. Non-villagers here are en route to somewhere else. Not all of them could tell you where they're heading. At a time in her life when she had burned bridges and turned her back on her bandmates to make a new home in this tucked-away place, Christine was a frequent visitor to the Rose. She dropped in every day, give or take at one point, around lunchtime or during the early evening, in need of human contact, as well as sustenance, and for want of anything better to do. I pull up a chair where she used to sit, recalling her silhouette cast by a lamp on the wall beside a corner table. I imagine her there, resting forward on one elbow, bare skin on wood, the thumb of her right hand pressed into her cheekbone, her palm flattened against her lips, obscuring her mouth. There are pretty dozing dogs at her feet. She stares, not at you, but into the middle distance, through a wax-dripped bottle plugged with a melted stub, which seems metaphorical. Her life, like the candle in the flask where she once lingered, flared as brilliantly as any in its day, but was snuffed out ahead of its time. My late friend, the celebrated bassist, Mo Foster, used to say that when a person dies, it's like a library burning down. So much talent, knowledge, insight and experience reduced in a flash to ash. She purchased her property here, the Quaves, a large Tudor house and estate with paddocks, gardens, cottages and barns, in 1990. Several years of renovations ensued, which turned out to be more extensive and expensive than she had anticipated. Had she realised, she said, she probably wouldn't have bought the place. She took up residence in 1998. She had quit Fleetwood Mac, the band that had made her rich and globally famous. At 55, her life, to the outsider, an endless jet-set whirl of luxury and privilege, was in reality a litany of loss. Of her mother, Beatrice, when Chris was only 25. Of two husbands, Mac bassist John McVie, whom she married the year her mother died, and Portuguese keyboardist Eddie Quintella, whom she wed when she was 43. Both marriages ended in divorce. Of the love of her life, wayward beach boy Dennis Wilson, who was her dangerously handsome obsession, who could not help but betray her with her acknowledged best friend because it was the kind of thing that Dennis did. Of the children she would have adored but never got round to having, mourning motherhood only after her fertility had expired. Of the solo career in which she dabbled, was enriched by, and that earned her great acclaim, but to which she could never quite rise to give her all. There was something of Miss Havisham about Christine, alone in her huge red brick house on its sprawling 19 acres where she planted many trees in memory of lost loved ones so that she could keep them all close by. Her estate was bigger than the whole village, she would joke. She wasn't far wrong. But she was a tragic Dickensian character only in passing. There was no moping about in a rotting wedding gown, no sconces laced with tangling cobwebs, no rat-infested wedding cake and banquet, no clock stopped at 9:20. Having survived catastrophe, although she resisted loneliness, she was alone again. Naturally, she would have given anything not to be. She had been unlucky in love, she admitted sadly. She confessed to having found that a real drag. Despite which, the romantic in her refused to yield its phantom. Virtually every song she wrote explored, celebrated, or mourned passionate love. I'm good at pathos, she said. I write about romantic despair a lot. That's my thing, but with a positive spin. The life she built by accident was one of huge creative achievement, but also of deep personal loss, which was an irony, given that she knew love precisely for all that it wasn't and was, a need, a greed, a paradigm, an excuse, a reason, an illusion, a blessed relief, an apology, a wonder, and, ultimately, a curse. She knew love better than anyone, better than love could know her. She had convinced herself that she was better off without it, yet that never stopped her craving it. like a crushed child suddenly wise to the lie of Father Christmas, yet as determined as ever to await the nocturnal call, she hoped against hope for her one true love to claim her. Part of her sensed him around every corner. Careful what you wished for. Truth was, she'd already found him. She had blithely worn his ring while he gnawed out her heart. The next best thing to being loved is being wanted. She tried hard to convince herself. Her needs were met, she agreed, by giving. Without ever having to stop to count the cost. With quiet generosity, she diminished the hold that money might have had over her, the way it has dominated and destroyed so many of her kind. She could spend without limit, go wherever in the world she chose. Instead, she purchased confinement at a distance from her roots. She immured herself within a chocolate box backwater, growing lonelier. A life becomes a story, only in hindsight. A star becomes a legend only in death. If a legend is someone who makes an unforgettable impression, affecting the lives of millions and is remembered long after their demise by way of an indelible legacy, Christine McVie was one. Yet her significance was largely unappreciated during her lifetime. When her passing was announced in November 2022, the shock and disbelief that vibrated from continent to continent related less to the tragic end of a remarkable musician who had contributed so much to music, and more to the fact that many who were not of her generation could not be sure exactly which of the women in Fleetwood Mac she was. "I adored her song Dreams," remarked a household name musician to me during a phone call after learning that Christine had died. "Her voice on that haunts me. It's sublime." But it was bandmate Stevie Nicks who wrote and who continues to sing the exquisite song that remains one of her signatures, the one that opens with, "Now here you go again, you say you want your freedom." It is, of course, a track on the band's 1977 12th album, the career and era-defining Rumours. Released as a single in May that year, Dreams went all the way. Although Chris created many of the Mac's most recognisable and best-loved hits, Dreams was not one of them. Nor did Christine care for it the first time she heard it. When Stevie first played it for me on the piano, it was just three chords and one note in the left hand, she remembered 29 years later in 2005.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.